Hey everyone, and welcome back to Do I Belong in Crotus Pren. In today's video, we're exploring a theory in which I pose that Jeffrey Johansson is secretly the clown, almost like an alter ego supervillain scenario. Let's get started. The clearest link that we can find, of course, is that of the name of Jeff, or more specifically, the longer version, Jeffrey, which is both the name of the clown and Jeffrey Johansson, the clown being called Jeffrey Hawk, and Jeff being called Jeffrey Johansson. Although the clown's actual name is Kenneth Chase, he goes by Jeffrey Hawk by choice after his father uncovers the finger of someone he murdered. Further, they also have the shared like for concocting mixtures or drinks, Jeff through microbreweries, and the clown through his tonics and mixtures of sedatives. There is also, of course, the fact that Jeff was released in Chapter 10, Darkness Among Us. Jeff is a member of the survivor roster, and so could reasonably be considered to be among the survivors, and more so than the Legion, who are quite evident killers with their knives and bloody masks. Looking at Clown and Jeff's perks, we can see some connections too. First off, we have a relatively trivial connection in that Jeff's perk Aftercare has a similar name to Clown's Afterpiece Tonic. Bamboozle is a clown perk that could possibly hint at the fact that Clown or Jeff is tricking or bamboozling the entity by doubling up as both a killer and a survivor. Distortion's imagery is a blurred image of Jeff himself, the wavy lines possibly signaling the wavy past or true self of Jeff, and how within the fog it is unclear on which side of the campfire that he resides. Distortion's flavor text reads, "Death fooled by the cloak of falcon feathers." In this text, we can alike death to the entity, as it is the main source of death in this realm. But the more interesting one we can alike is the falcon feathers. Feathers being the first item that the clown begins to collect before he moves on to more grotesque things like fingers. A few feathers from his early collections can also be seen in his add-ons. So this suggests that death, or the entity, is being fooled by the cloak of falcon feathers, or the clown costume, basically. There is also the fact that Clown's new name he chooses is Jeffrey Hawk. Much like Jeff, in his lore moving onto his new life and as an artist, he then makes this reference to falcon feathers, a bird similar to a hawk, except slightly smaller, both predatory though. And by looking at Jeff and Clown, Jeff is the smaller of the two. Another feature to note on is Jeff's scar that cuts across the left side of his face and over his eye. The clown in a similar fashion has makeup in the exact same location, over both of his eyes, possibly to hide the scar there. As I mean, well, if you were a performing clown, it would be a little unnerving to have a massive scar across your face. It would make the mood a lot less light, potentially. So it would make sense to try and incorporate it into your face paint to make sure no one saw it. The both of them also have a pet animal or animal companion. Jeff has his dog and Clown has Maurice, his horse. Generally, the two characters share similarities in that they have bad parents, love making collections of things, and are both to a degree in the entertainment or art industry. But let's look at some cosmetics now. In this headpiece named Corpse Paint, we can read, "He pulls his hair back, draws his eyes black, and smears his face with corpse paint for a pure experience." In this cosmetic, Jeff paints his face white, further specifically with black eyes, much like Clown's appearance in game. The shirt that goes with this headpiece is also drenched in what looks to be blood. It could be fake, sure, but it makes you think. There's also a whole theme of death imagery that runs through Jeff's cosmetics, even in his base look cosmetics where we can see the Grim Reaper pictured. Both Clown and Jeff also share similarities in that they both have a thing dangling from their waist. Clown has his ring with fingers on and Jeff has a can opener, but both resemble a ringed shape. Looking into the lore, we can find that when Jeff gets into a fight, he is possibly left with partial sight, which could explain why Clown specifically produced the tonic to also inflict distorted sight, as to inflict his own weakness on others almost. There's also a big theme for each character of alcohol or drinking. Clown binges on drink and Jeff loves beer, hence the can opener around his waist. Finally, one of Clown's aliases is the Ringmaster, rings being a prominent feature on Jeff, who has a bunch around each of his hands. Now, you may be thinking, okay, but why would you ever make this connection? Jeff is a nice, quiet, harmless artist who doesn't seem like he'd hurt anyone, whereas Clown is a vicious psychopath intent on pain and death. That's a pretty big difference, and yep, that would be totally right. Further, Clown is stated in the lore to be based in America, whereas Jeff is in Ormond, which is in Canada. Clown is noted to be a track star in school, whereas Jeff is noted in school to be quiet and lonely and avoided large crowds. Clown was also born in 1932, and Jeff was seemingly born closer to the 70s or 80s. So, we're here again. It doesn't work. So, what I want to suggest instead is that Jeff is actually the clown's son. I'm sorry, but the similarities all being there seems far too substantial, and really in this way, their stories can connect in what is actually a far more reasonable way than them somehow being the same person, or Jeff covertly being the clown, almost like an alter ego. We can align their stories first by looking at their lore, beginning with Clown. Clown's story begins in the lore when he's young in 1932. During his birth, it kills his mother in the process. This leads himself and his father to become very disconnected, and also leads his father to become an alcoholic, stating that eventually they became so distant that they practically live separate lives. During this time, Clown excels at athletics and begins collecting feathers, eventually getting anesthetic from a dentist to catch birds for himself, to help add to his collection. By the late 1940s, Clown is working and had begun killing larger animals like squirrels, raccoons, and dogs. In 1954, this escalates further when he kills a young man. Clown, after killing this guy, cuts off his finger and hides it in a cigar box in the crawl space of his house, where his father later finds it. Clown sees that he's found it and flees home. This leads to Clown eventually running into and joining a traveling circus. It's stated he then stays here for the next decade, with the circus, as the clown, and under the name Jeffrey Hawk. He uses this time while moving from town to town to kill people and collect fingers, falling slowly into drinking, junk food, and drugs. During this time is when I think it could be possible that Clown has, well, Jeff. Here's my suggestion. While on the road, he meets a woman, specifically a redhead, whilst the traveling circus goes through the town of Ormond. Together, Clown and this redheaded woman have a son, who they name Jeffrey, after his father, Jeffrey Hawk. Presumably, the name Johansson could come from Jeff's mother's side. In Jeff's lore, it's noted that his parents would constantly fight, which eventually result in their divorce. So this could potentially result in Clown claiming Jeff's mother's finger, the first of his iridescent add-ons. Further, the clown's abuse reaches Jeff, taking his finger also. One add-on from Clown that is particularly interesting is the iridescent one named Tattoo's Middle Finger. The description reading, "The prized middle finger of a large tattooed man has a faint taste of machinery oil." Now, who in the realm do we know of aside Jeff Johansson that is large and tattooed? Jeff is the only one to the best of my knowledge, and he's also somewhat larger than most of the other survivors. The machinery oil could possibly be from his time at a concert. This event would make sense why he would hold resentment towards his father and also move entirely away from him right after this event. It's also something super sadistic that the clown would totally do, have a wife and a kid and then cut their fingers off as trophies. Before Jeff leaves Ormond though, he briefly encounters Frank of the Legion, painting a mural for him at the abandoned lodge. After their divorce, Jeff goes with his mother to Manitoba, miles away from his hometown and dad. This seems to make Jeff spiral out of control somewhat, falling into the same issues as the clown. Drinking, becoming a roadie, and presumably traveling around much like Clown did, like Clown's time in the traveling circus. Whilst at a concert, this leads to him getting into a fight and damaging his eye. This is the point where Jeff decides to change his life and not go down the same path as the clown, his father. He goes to art school, gets a steadier job, and allows brewing and tattoo design to be small hobbies on the side instead of obsessions or things he did in excess. Moderation, basically. Finally, he receives a call that his father has died, or basically from our perspective, the entity has taken the clown. So Jeff returns to Ormond to discover that his father left him specifically a guitar, which is left with a sticky note that reads, "For my boy." Few interesting things here. For example, the sticky note, something that connects to Clown and his concoctions, but also alcohol addiction or unhealthy habits, I guess. Also the fact that the clown leaves a guitar, potentially his most prized trophy that he claimed from a victim. Potentially this is Kate's guitar. Kate being the character that released alongside the clown in the Curtain Call chapter. After this, Jeff takes a 12-pack of beer and heads to the abandoned lodge. Beer and the lodge being reminders of his father, the clown, an alcohol-driven criminal. It's here where he's taken into the fog. Interestingly, in this moment where he remembers his father and maybe embraces some inner darkness, this allows the entity to take him. Now you may be thinking, okay, but Jeff is quite clearly not missing a middle finger, so how would Clown have it in his possession, or potentially as an add-on. The slightly more ridiculous answer to this is that, well, prosthetics exist. Ash has a whole new hand that's completely functioning that looks like a normal hand. The more reasonable explanation, though, is that when Jeff entered the realm of the entity, he regained the finger. This is a common theme for the entity to restore certain things after taking people, or to alternately inflict them with different things. For example, when the twins were taken, Victor was completely resurrected and was brought back to life. where before he had almost completely withered away whilst attached to Charlotte. The alternate being where the entity has taken a killer and changed them in some way. For example, tormenting and changing Trapper, or making the killers larger, like Play being far taller than she realistically would be. The entity in its own realm is basically a god and controls all that is inside of it. It can distort and change as it pleases, so really, growing Jeff's finger back isn't a stretch at all. The reason behind regrowing his finger could be as simple as wanting Jeff to be fully capable of doing generators and such to be able to properly feed off of the hope he has to escape. So, leaving Ormond for Jeff was a large decision in Jeff's life. Jeff decides to leave, escape the abuse, and also break the cycle of becoming like his father before him, instead opting for a simple and reserved life away from everything to do with his father. This explains Jeff's similar traits of having a rough start, but the capability to be friendly and interact functionally with society, also for his interest in concoctions and collecting, as well as painting or art. These are all elements that remind him of his father, but are also an escape for him, making his escape a reminder and torment, but also the thing that relieves him and reminds him to not become the man that his father did. Hey, it's just a theory though. Let me know what you think, and if I do in fact belong in Crotus Bren. Thanks, and goodbye.